Welcome to World Tech Update. I'm Martin Williams. And this week we're coming to you from Tokyo. Nick is on vacation, but he's getting into the Olympic spirit. And we'll have a special report from him later. We'll also be taking a look at some of the mobile phones from last week's Mobile World Congress that we couldn't fit in the show. And we'll be taking a look at a very unusual wedding. But we start off this week in Europe. And late Tuesday, Google said that it's the subject of a preliminary investigation by the European Commission. The Commission, which is the EU's highest antitrust authority, often conducts such preliminary probes before deciding whether to launch full investigations. It comes after complaints from three companies: UK price comparison website Foundam, French legal search engine eJustice, and German search site Chow. In a blog posting, Google denied that it's doing anything wrong and hinted that Microsoft may have had a hand in two of the complaints. It's revolutionized the way that people buy and consume music. Apple's iPod launched 8.5 years ago in October 2001, and now the companion iTunes Music Store reaches a milestone. On Wednesday, the service sold its 10 billionth song. Apple's website had been counting up to the moment all week. The company said it would give $10,000 in iTunes Store credit to the person who purchased the song. The iTunes Music Store launched on April 28, 2003 in the US, a little after the iPod came out, and began its international expansion the following year. Sticking with Apple and iPhone, iPad, iDo, for an Apple mad couple in New York, the wedding of their dreams came true on Valentine's Day this year when they got married in Apple's flagship Fifth Avenue store. Joseph and Ting Li, who are self-described Apple fans, walked into the store with friends at 1 minute past midnight on February 14th. Although the store isn't officially available for marriages, the staff apparently allowed the impromptu ceremony. The rings were attached to a first-generation iPod, and the vows were written on a card that said, "I love you more than this," with a picture of an iPhone. They were married by Henry Hu, who dressed in Steve Jobs' trademark black turtleneck. Henry said he's open to other tech-themed weddings, even dressing up as Clippy the Paperclip for any Microsoft mad couples. I'm not sure he's going to find any of those. Now to Anaheim in California and the PMA show, where Sony showed off some prototype cameras that combine a compact body with interchangeable lenses. The Sony camera does away with the mirror box found in larger SLR cameras to realize the smaller size. That's a similar concept to the Micro Four Thirds system used by rivals like Panasonic. But the Sony prototype includes an APS-C image sensor, which is larger than the sensor on Micro Four Thirds cameras. That should mean higher or better quality pictures, but we won't know exactly how it stacks up until later this year when the camera's available. In addition to still images, Sony said it will shoot 1080p high-definition video. California startup Bloom Energy unveiled on Wednesday its fuel cell server, a device that could revolutionize the way homes and businesses get electricity. It creates power from a reaction between air and a fuel source, such as natural gas or ethanol, via an electrochemical process. The fuel cells themselves are made from sand.
Today it produces 25 watts, enough for a light bulb. 2 years from now, stay tuned.
Bloom says its technology can deliver energy that's clean, reliable, and inexpensive, while being disconnected from the power grid. The company's delivering the fuel cells in big boxes for large enterprises now, and in about 10 years it expects to begin selling smaller energy servers to consumers. And now for some more news from Mobile World Congress in Barcelona that we couldn't fit into last week's show, and we start with some new cell phones. This is the first handset from sports brand Puma. Naturally, there are sports-related functions. For runners and cyclists, for example, it'll keep track of speed, distance, and pace. It can be recharged via a solar panel on the phone's rear, and the phone will tell you how many text messages or songs you're getting thanks to the sun. The phone will be out in Europe in April and later in other markets. From Israel's Else comes this phone, the first Else. It's designed to be operated with one hand, so the menus are arranged in a thumb-friendly fan design. Main functions splay out when activated and further expand to reveal more data. The 3G handset should be ready in the second quarter, but interacts with a server system run by Else, so will only be available through certain carriers. And Taiwan's HTC unveiled an update to its Nexus One, the so-called Google phone. The HTC Desire adds an FM radio and an improved version of the Sense user interface. The new interface has improvements on a number of areas, including social networking, internet browsing, email, and contact management. Here in Tokyo, mobile TV can be received citywide from transmitters on Tokyo Tower behind me. At Mobile World Congress, I met with Ireland's Solaris Mobile that was demonstrating a system with a much wider reach. The system receives TV and radio broadcasts from a satellite, so it can be used all over Europe. A network of terrestrial transmitters, already on the air in Paris and Barcelona, fills in the gaps the satellite can't reach to provide uninterrupted service in cities.
By using this combination of satellites, which provides great coverage, broad coverage, national coverage, straight away, with the throughput of terrestrial networks in urban areas, it's very cost-effective, very efficient, and very rapid to deploy.
Solaris has also produced this prototype receiver that picks up the broadcasts and streams them over Wi-Fi so they can be watched on compatible smartphones. The device is still a prototype and will eventually be smaller, the company said. Solaris Mobile is in talks with carriers now, hoping to start a service soon. The fashion world got its first taste of 3D TV this week when British fashion house Burberry premiered its autumn-winter 2010-2011 collection in London. While guests in London got to see the new clothes up close, the company sent a 3D satellite signal to parties taking place in Paris, Dubai, New York, Los Angeles, and Tokyo.
I'm excited. It's like the avatar of fashion, and a good example of how our industry continues to evolve and connect to technology.
Now, as I said at the top of this week's show, Nick is on vacation, but that hasn't stopped him working. Nick, I understand you've been trying a new product for us.
Thanks, Martin. Well, in the spirit of the Winter Olympics, I'm out here in California testing out the Contour HD wearable camera. It ships with a goggle mount and a helmet mount. It's a small form factor, and the outside is made of anodized aluminum. On the back is a one-touch power on and power off, and on the top, all you need to do to start recording is slide this forward and you go ahead. And what you're seeing now is some footage from the Contour HD. It ships with a 2 GB card, which means you can capture between 30 and 60 minutes of footage. At 720p, it shoots at 30 frames per second, and at WVGA resolution, it shoots at 60 frames a second. There's also a 1080p model, but right now we're testing out the 720p model. It's water, shock, and snow resistant, and you'll see that in this upcoming clip.
Well, that would be fun to get on camera.
It comes with a rechargeable battery that you can recharge using the USB port on your computer. There's an online community for you to share your videos that you're also seeing now, and it comes with a light editing software to put together your clips. It captures full audio, though one of the problems that I found is if you're going at any kind of significant speed, all you hear is wind. Well, Martin, the 720p Contour HD ships for $250. The 1080p Contour HD ships for $330. That's all from here in California. Now back to you.
Thanks, Nick. Well, based on that film, I'm not sure you're going to be making Team USA anytime soon, but it looks like you're having a fun vacation. Well, that's it for this week's World Tech Update. Next week, Nick is back, and I'll be on the road in Hanover, Germany at the CeBIT show, so come back and join us for that. I'm Martin Williams, and on behalf of everybody at IDG News Service, thanks for watching, and we'll see you next week.